If someone's willing to spend $40 billion to buy Twitter, then that's not going to happen unless he has some very detailed ideas for how he thinks Twitter could be made better.
Local time, everyone, and welcome to this new episode of Innovative Minds with Audrey Tang. Today, we continue our focus on innovation in the world of ideas with a world-famous programmer, co-founder of Ethereum, Vitalik Buterin. He has 2 million followers on Twitter. He has contributed as a developer and as a patron to many free software projects. He is involved in the research on plurality, technology for collaborative diversity and democracy. Please join me in welcoming our guest. Hi, Vitalik.
Hi, Audrey. How are you?
Hi, pretty good. A good local time. I'm told that you're in the same time zone, actually. You're in Singapore, right?
Yes, I am.
Okay. You've been in Taiwan several times. I remember meeting you when I first became digital minister in 2016. We talk about the DAO fork. We talk about climate change. Since then, I'm told that you now speak fluent Mandarin. Can you use Mandarin to greet our audience? Mm-hmm.
你要我说什么?你要我说大家好吗?大家好,很好啊。好吧,大家好也可以。好啊,那大家好。
In your Twitter bio, you referred to, I think it was Nick Bostrom's Fable of the Dragon-Tyrant. And the fable tells the story of a kingdom where a dragon demands a tribute of thousands of people's life per day. And giving one's life to the dragon seems to be a certainty of nature, and people resign to their fate. However, one day, a group of scientists proposed to eliminate the dragon with a missile, and they gained support from the majority of the population. And after 12 years of research, well, they eliminated the dragon, and a new world opens up. So, of course, the moral of the story is that we should try to overcome the tyranny of death with science and technology. So, Vitalik, according to you, from what other tyranny must we and could we free ourselves thanks to science and technology?
I think the goal of science and technology in general is to try to make our lives easier. I think the world would be better if everything was automated and people did not have to work just to survive, for example. Mm-hmm. I think the world would be much better if food was easily available and water was easily available for everyone. And those are all things that I think technology has already brought us a lot closer to, and could bring us even closer to over the next few decades. Mm-hmm. Aside from those kinds of technologies, I also think like social technology is important. So technologies that make it easier for people to organize and coordinate with large groups. And I guess you can say free us from the tyranny of badly designed coordination, right? So one of the ways I sometimes think about this is you can think of authoritarianism as being like 1960s era chemotherapy, mm-hmm. right? Like when people first started figuring out how to deal with cancer, the therapies that they came up with at the beginning were sometimes mm-hmm. Almost as bad as the cancer itself, and mm-hmm. sometimes even worse, mm-hmm. right? The only way to not have to deal with bad medicine, it turned out to actually be better medicine. And I see a lot of the digital democracy work that's being done by yourself and Glenn and many other people as being in that direction. I hope that creating better coordination is also something that can free billions of people from various kinds of tyrannies this century.
Mm-hmm. Right. So if I hear you right, you first talk about the tyranny of kind of the material scarcity, the fact that before modern technologies, people have to work very long hours to secure food supply and things like that. So that was what already happened, right? A couple of centuries ago, there's technologies that massively helped solving this issue. But you're comparing that to coordination failure, which is in the time that people invented ways, hierarchical or even tyrannical, like the name tyrant, right, is actually one way to solve a coordination problem, namely handing authoritarian power to a single person. But you compare that to something that is much more brute force and that may end up causing more problems. So I think this is a very fresh look to technology, namely treating social technology as technologists. So do you identify yourself as a social technologist? And how would you define that term in the language that like everyone can understand?
I would say so. I would describe social technology as being technologies that help people like better coordinate with and interact with each other. Mm-hmm. And I think that is encompasses a very big group of things, right? Mm-hmm. So like, for example, Wikipedia is a social technology, podcasts are a social technology, liberal democracy is a social technology. Mm-hmm. So it's a concept that I think includes like very many different kinds of things. So, like, basically, mm-hmm. ways to organize that we have just discovered or invented over the centuries that are, in whatever ways better than the ways that we knew about before.
Right. So if I hear you right, it's not necessarily digital technologies. Basically, liberal democracy can be thought of as a kind of technology because it brings people together. They coordinate in ways that didn't exist before, the idea of a liberal democracy. So in this line of thought, what is the invention that you have personally participated in that you're proud of in a social technologist sense? And did you expect the technology to be used in such a pro-social way?
I don't think there's like any very specific one answer, but mm-hmm. definitely the collection of technologies that emerged in and around the blockchain and the Ethereum space. Mm-hmm. There have obviously been quite a lot, mm-hmm. right? Like that includes social kind of coordination technologies. So things like DAOs, for example, mm-hmm. Includes the blockchain itself. I mean, it includes a lot of the financial infrastructure that and like DeFi that's been built on the blockchain. Even some of the like experiments in very new forms of governance and voting. So like the different forms of quadratic funding that have happened inside of that ecosystem, for example. Mm-hmm. I think those are all definitely not things that I would have expected were even possible, like 5 years before I started working with them. I think like a lot of them are still experiments. A lot of them have had the consequences that I expected them to have, and a lot of them have also had many kinds of consequences that I have not expected.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so a little bit more personal question, if that's okay with you. So within those 5 years, you've gone from being a gifted programmer in a meeting in the crypto world and advocate of open source, but now you're a superstar more and more mainstream media pay attention to your work and your thoughts. Were you ready to embrace this trajectory, and what does your new status mean to you?
I was definitely not expecting that Ethereum would succeed to the extent that it has, or that I myself would become well known to anywhere close to the extent that I have. Mm-hmm. I will say that it's definitely not just a benefit. It has lots of downsides too, right? Mm-hmm. Just going around in public, often I would just get noticed by various people. When all I want to do is just like have some quiet time to myself. Whenever I just say anything, there's lots of people like jumping at the opportunity to try to come to some conclusion about it, or criticize it if I make any kind of mistake, or just say something that they don't like. So there are downsides too. I think on the whole, it's a responsibility even more than it is some kind of benefit, because it basically means that there are lots of people that are looking up to, I'll say not just myself, but also this kind of bigger community of, you could think of it as decentralization researchers and developers that have formed around the space. And lots of people are looking to this community for the solutions to big problems that the world has. And I think that comes with a responsibility to deliver. And that could be a big responsibility to have.
Yeah, trust me, I know that feeling. I think one of the points that we talked about when we first met in 2016 was that a external pressure, like responding to climate change, climate crisis, like the DAO fork and things like that, they forced the community to think in innovative ways, in inventive ways, and so on. So, and you just mentioned that more and more people from the mainstream look to decentralization as possible solutions, are one of the inspiration sources to the new challenges of the world. Do you have some themes in mind? Like what the kind of the attention that you're receiving, what kind of problems, in addition to, of course, financial inclusion in hostile environments where banking system doesn't work like the original problem? What other problems do you have in mind when you say that?
I think lots of people want just better forms of governance in general. Mm-hmm. Like they, a lot of people, I think, see that the democratic forms of governance that are the most mainstream today, mm-hmm. Have a lot of problems to how they're working, and there's a lot of ways in which they're not adapted to the 21st century, but they're also even more afraid of what centralized governance could end up doing. Mm-hmm. And so I think there's a lot of people who are looking for some form of governance that is decentralized, but that also is updated to the 21st century. It does a better job of helping people come to consensuses that most people find very agreeable than the tools that we have now. And I think that's true for organizations. Mm-hmm. I think that's very true in the social media space. Like there's a lot of people who are interested in trying to come up with better forms of social media. And I think this is an area where everyone, I think, recognizes that there is a lot of room to change and improve it somehow, right? Like, on one side, there's people like Elon Musk that I think announced today that he wants to take mm-hmm. over Twitter. Mm-hmm. And if someone's willing to spend $40 billion to buy Twitter, then that's not going to happen unless he has some very detailed ideas for how he thinks Twitter could be made better. On the other hand, within the crypto space, there's at least 20 different projects trying to do decentralized social media. Some of them are coin-based, some of them are per-person voting-based. There's this very big, long collection of ideas that people are experimenting with. For improving content curation, for improving monetization, and various other things. So it's a problem that a lot of people are watching, I think, both inside of the crypto space and outside of it. Figuring out whether or not there are good solutions that work, and what forms of decentralization make mm-hmm. sense there, I think, is also a problem that's very interesting and important.
Okay, so there's two broad problems that you outlined that people look to decentralization as a possible source of solution. One is the just democracy itself, right, in backslide, the political environment. And the other thing is centralized social media platforms that are just not very pro-social, right? So somewhat antisocial, and how to solve that. And I'm reminded of a couple years ago, you had a tweet where you expressed your pessimism about, and I quote, the ability of centralized social media platforms to stay highly independent of the political environment of the country that they are centered in, end of quote. Now, it's hard to tell from this tweet alone, like whether you mean that the social media should stay independent or not, whether the political environment you have in mind is democratic or authoritarian. And I would not like to quote you out of context. So can you add back some of the context, like today, between the political environment and the centralized social media? Do you see a pathway in which the relationship, the two, can change thanks to decentralization, or which one should change first and in which direction?
Sure. I think there is a lot of value to this concept of like some kind of global public square where, not just governments, diplomats, but also people from around the world can talk to each other and exchange ideas and better understand each other. And I think like up to about 10 years ago, a lot of people kind of passively, without really thinking about it, mm-hmm. sort of assumes that the large Silicon Valley tech platforms mm-hmm. were that, right? Mm-hmm. Because at the time, the amount of pressure on them to do specific things was much less. And it sort of didn't really matter as much whether they were based in, the United States or Switzerland or Malaysia or Europe or wherever else. But since then, the just global political environment has become much more competitive, and both between countries and within different countries. And so we've seen like lots of specific incidences of these platforms making these kind of very opinionated decisions on which people to kick off of Twitter, which people to keep on Twitter, which people to put warning labels beside, and so on and so forth. And like I think the consequences of every one of those decisions is complicated, and it's possible that some of them are good and some of them are bad. But like in general, I think it does have the consequence that it has kind of corroded their reputation as being able to be that global public square, right? Because people are realizing that basically there is this small group of people that is based around one place that comes from a very similar culture, mm-hmm. like not even just American culture, but a very specific subset of American culture mm-hmm. that is making a lot of these judgment calls. The responses that we've seen from that, like a lot of even governments around the world that have started banning Twitter recently, like they even cite its kind of lack of neutrality and the extent to which it its moderation basically favors Western ideas as one of the big reasons why they're doing that. Mm-hmm. So I do think there is this open question, right, of if these platforms, in their current form are not able to be this global public square, then what should the global public square be, right? What would even make sense for a global public square of some kinds to look like? Should there even be something similar to Twitter, right? What if we do basically want just a large number of islands that where people can more easily talk inside of their communities, and there's relatively less interaction happening between those communities, and so if you say something, it doesn't just get equally broadcasted to the world all at once. Mm-hmm. I think there's many different kinds of decentralization there, right? You can talk about making a blockchain-like platform that doesn't censor anything. But then even if it doesn't censor anything, there's still the question of what algorithm gets used to prioritize which messages get on top, right? At the very least, because people are going to spam it, you have to have some algorithm. And then, mm-hmm. Who decides that? Or, can it be something neutral? Or is it something federated? Is it something where people themselves kind of choose, which views of the world that they have? Is it some kind of, governance across the system that is democratic between the platform's users somehow? I don't know. I do think that I'm happy to see people thinking about these kinds of ideas and trying to figure out what kind of a global public square, you know, or lack of one, actually makes sense. I mean, I definitely don't think, you know, we have the perfect answer yet. I think this is still one of those things where, like, we still have to, you know, try and understand better what's going to come after.
All right. So you mentioned a couple of positive things, all right? You compared that to spam, and spam fighting around the turn of the century was actually one of the early success of the decentralized internet community, in which that we do not have to blacklist entire jurisdictions from sending emails, but rather formed local communities that reported spam voluntarily and formed norms around spam house and things like that. And you also mentioned Wikipedia, which to my knowledge is of course blocked in some places, but is largely seen as run by a norm-aware local community, especially if it's not English Wikipedia, by local language Wikipedia, and so on. So there's some kind of promising pilots in open source decentralization in tackling this issue that now people associate with social media. But people don't immediately think of crypto when they think of possible solutions. I mean, you and I know there's a lot of cryptography involved if we're going to build new global public squares that can be plural in the sense that local communities take control. But people's general association to crypto is not that. I remember Peter Thiel once said, and I quote, crypto is libertarian and AI is communist, end of quote. Now, AI is communist. Nowadays, people understand it's because, well, the code is driven by data. The data writes the code and data holds into centralized data stores. But libertarian, in a sense, carries this notion that it's just a bunch of individuals and not trusting any communities and so on. So as an advocate of a more plural, community-oriented decentralization, how would you say, or how would you put that differently in this mainstream association of crypto nowadays?
I think different people have different visions of what the word libertarian means, mm-hmm. and like different people also have different visions of what crypto means, mm-hmm. right? Like, you know, on the one side, there is this kind of, like, you could call it, you know, Bitcoin maximalism, the world is dangerous, trust no one, you know, mm-hmm. maybe trust your family, but otherwise, like, always guard, keep your guard out kind of vision. Mm-hmm. But then on the other hand, you know, there's this vision that involves like a lot of you know, people forming various different kinds of you know, decentralized organizations that cooperate with each other, and where trust is often involved, but it's not about reducing trust, it's about the choice of whom to trust. Mm-hmm. So I think that, you know, within the crypto space, like that entire spectrum of visions exists, right? So, like, you know, there is Bitcoin, which is trying to just be about, like, helping people protect their own finances. And then on Ethereum, like, there are some people who use Ether as just a form of money that's kind of very protected, and they've own it themselves, and they're attracted to that. But then there's also people who, you know, participate in DAOs, for example, and where these DAOs often end up collectively allocating pretty large amounts of capital now, mm-hmm. right? So, like, for example, even like right now, the Uniswap DAO has more funds in it than the Ethereum Foundation. Mm-hmm. So in some ways, you know, the Ethereum Foundation isn't even the largest Ethereum ecosystem player anymore. You know, there's projects like Gitcoin that have been running for more than 2 years. There's all kinds of like other smaller projects that people are trying to make. Mm-hmm. And so I personally don't see, you know, Ethereum, for example, as being necessarily about like any one of those visions. Mm-hmm. Like I definitely don't see it as being like about trying to realize like kind of my favorite point on the spectrum. Mm-hmm. I see it as being a collection of people that I think are mostly aligned on a lot of things, but also disagree on quite a lot of things. And where there is enough space for people to try these different ideas and see what ends up actually working, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that's important for crypto in general to kind of be like that and be open to people of many different kinds of philosophies, right? Because it definitely is true that the largest applications of crypto in terms of numbers of users today tends to revolve around like just having money and sending money around. But you know, there are definitely these other groups of people that are trying to also do all kinds of other things. And I think there's a lot of very interesting ideas in there, and I'm confident that you know, at least some of them are going to be quite successful.
Okay, yeah, I'm reminded that during the first kind of internet .com boom, I always reminded people that it's not just .com. For example, Wikipedia is .org, so not the entire internet is optimizing for the financial profit motive. There are .org, .edu for education, .net, and many other thoughts as well. So during the war in Ukraine, we saw the emergence of open source intelligence communities on the networks. The cryptography, of course, helped them to send out uncensored information, and the communities even worked together to out-meme, essentially, the other narrative over the course of the conflict. In the cryptocurrency space, donations have also helped to support from afar. How does this inspire you, and do you see, on the flip side, any harms being caused by this kind of open source collaborations in this conflict?
I think the war in Ukraine was definitely a watershed moment for the crypto space in a lot of ways, right? Because the amount of funding that was sent to the both the Ukrainian government and to charities, supporting refugees and humanitarian causes, it was large. Like in total, I think it's over $130 million right now. Like these are more money than was provided by like even some fairly significant nation states. So I think it shows that whatever crypto is going to be, crypto is not going to be nothing. In some ways, that really puts it into a very different category from what it was before in the 2010s, which is this the kind of small thing that is kind of growing up and still trying to quietly develop itself. So I think, in this particular case, I've been very impressed by the crypto communities, like both the Ethereum community and many other communities that have stepped up to help. Definitely impressed, but with the just Ukrainian government's level of understanding and willingness to work with, both crypto, but also many other kinds of fairly new internet technologies. So I definitely think that like, there's a lot of good that has been done both with crypto and with the internet in general, though there definitely are risks as well, right? Like one particular example of this is I think there was a subreddit, I forget the name, where people were basically like gathering up and like posting pictures of things happening in Ukraine. And there were some signs that like possibly some of those pictures were actually being like watched by Russian intelligence and ended up being used as information for them to figure out who to target, right? Mm-hmm. And like that definitely is a tragedy, right? And like it's, a tragedy, not just from kind of my point of view, as someone who wants Ukraine to survive and Ukraine to prosper, but also just from the point of view that like these are definitely well-meaning people that are just are curious about what's going on and that feel compassion for people in the situation and wants to help, but they ended up doing things that had kind of the opposite effects to what they expected, right? Mm-hmm. And like this to me is an example of one of the challenges of this kind of technology, which is that like it empowers a lot of people who weren't empowered before, but a lot of the people that get like freshly empowered in this way, they don't really have much experience having that kind of power. And so sometimes, they do end up making mistakes and they end up kind of quickly taking actions that they're going to end up regretting, right? And like, to me, that's definitely a metaphor for like things that happen in crypto as well, for example, right? Like in crypto, there's definitely plenty of people who make mistakes. There's plenty of people that fall for various kinds of scams. There's plenty of people that just accidentally send their coins to the zero address and can't get them out, and so forth. And so it does show how kind of the rapid development of technology does need to, I think, coincide with education happening around that technology at the same time. And like how to do that kind of education and actually properly put effort into it, I think it's a challenge that exists in the wider world. I think it's a challenge that also exists in the crypto space as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the kind of communication from the Ukrainian cabinet, and I've watched like real-time Twitter exchanges between you and the Ukrainian officials. I think that has a very prominent educational effect, right? The fact-checking process that led you to believe that this wallet actually lead to charities and other pro-social efforts, and the kind of steps that you're taking, not just through private communications, but publicly, so that people can learn these are the things to watch out for, and so on. I think it's quite educational for a lot of people. So for decentralized and open source communities, is there a more kind of lead by example in addition to regulation form of, let's say, just norm-based interaction that you can advise officials? And I'm, of course, wearing the digital ministry.tw hat, but in general, to the liberal democracies, is there something that we can proactively do with an eye on leading by example?
I think setting good examples is definitely something that's really important. Mm-hmm. And in some ways, I think in an environment as chaotic as both the crypto space, but also more of the world in general, it's often the only thing that you can do. Mm-hmm. Right. And I think we've seen in the crypto space, like the power of examples being used both for good and for ill in certain cases. Right. Like if you look at, even like smart contract security, for example, mm-hmm. I think we've been seeing a steady upward trend in like parts of crypto space. Definitely not all of it, but I think very big parts of it in and of taking security more and more seriously. And we've come a lot from the days in 2016 when the DAO broke or got hacked as a result of a fairly simple bug to systems like Uniswap or MakerDAO that have survived for years without issues. Mm-hmm. But then also we've been seeing negative examples. Like one of them might be this phenomenon where people who create newer cryptocurrencies end up kind of the pre-mine, share of the initial issuance that just directly goes to the founders and to a very small number of people. Like that, in a lot of cases, has been increasing over time, right? Like before 2015, most cryptocurrency pre-mines were either very small or zero, but now, especially in the VC space, mm-hmm. it often comes pretty close to 100%. Mm-hmm. And like that's an example of a trend that I do think that did come as a result of people like imitating each other, but it's a trend that I think also has a lot of negatives. Mm-hmm. So in general, I think making like better positive examples is possible. There are lots of projects that I think are doing it. Within the Ethereum space, I think there have been some pretty great examples of self-policing. Mm-hmm. Like one other success story of self-policing in Ethereum that I think I can tell is client diversity, right? So what happens here is basically that we have like four, maybe five now, implementations of the Ethereum protocol. So these are different independently developed pieces of code that all try to implement the Ethereum spec. Mm-hmm. And one of the reasons why we have many of them is so that if there is a bug in any one of them, then as long as the portion of the nodes that use that one client is less than one half or even less than two thirds, mm-hmm. the network doesn't just completely break to the same extent. Mm-hmm. But the problem though is that there was one client, Prism, that actually started off having a market share of like somewhere around 70 or 80%. And so even though we had this kind of decentralization of many implementations in theory, in in practice, like most people were using one of them, and so we did not end up actually getting that much benefit. And there was this large community-wide effort to just call up and convince all major stakers, staking providers, people writing the tools that help other people stake, to try to like not make Prism be the default and to try to kind of balance things out more and start using other clients. And it seems like that's actually been successful now. Like it seems like Prism is down to a little bit under or a little bit over 50%. And the rest is like a balance between the other clients, right? Mm-hmm. So like positive examples like that can and do happen. But at the same time, he definitely wants to also create these race to the bottom situations where someone does something bad and they suffer no negative consequences and other people take a clue from that. And then that just becomes a pattern, right? Mm-hmm. And I do think that maybe in part for that reason, like it's not just about people convincing other people to be nice. Like sometimes mm-hmm. there does have to be some mm-hmm. kind of power, like some kind of actual carrot or actual stick behind these norms. Mm-hmm. Now that doesn't like always have to be regulation. Like mm-hmm. sometimes it can be, users inside of a space, but there does need to be a carrot or stick of some kind to prevent the negative examples from forming. But I do think that like if you do, or if we do our job better as kind of, I guess, gardeners of the community is one of the metaphors that I like, then the power of example does most of the work. And the amount of like intervention that you have to actually do yourself should possibly be significant at the beginning, but eventually stabilize to a level where it becomes a pretty low over time.
Mm-hmm. A gardener, you said, like in a garden. So doing things like, merging the branches and purging. So what I'm getting from your answer is that the leadership or gardening, as you put it, I like the term, the gardeners are now seeing that it's not just about hard-coded code in the protocol or in the software that ensures balance and accountability and distributed power and so on, but rather the way that we behave between the gardeners and so on must itself lead by example. And it's not just about public records of the implementation maintainers doing the council of video conference meetings. Of course, that's a very good start, but also about proactively treating us, not just doing infrastructure, but critical infrastructure, it's almost like water supply, right? And adapting the cybersecurity norms, the review norms, the various norms that really only critical infrastructure providers take responsibility to themselves. Is that a fair summary? Mm-hmm. Cool. And so are there innovations in this regard that you see recently as important in ensuring this kind of balance of accountability and distributed power? Because we talk about excesses, criminal behaviors, and things like that. Innovations that empower the people who just want to exploit other people. And we talked also about social technologies. One of the early insight of Wikipedia is that with sufficient amount of ultimate moderator tools, the game of attrition can be played in the favor of the moderators so that people who want to do vandalism and so on, their time must be burned much more than the moderators and so on. So what kind of innovations in that regard do you see as important either in Ethereum or other crypto or any decentralized community that is maybe promising for us to invest more either time or funding toward?
Yeah, I mean, I think the answer depends on what kind of risk that you are trying to guard mm-hmm. against, right? So, like, one example of a risk that you might want to guard against is the risk that there will be a kind of hostile takeover of the governance of the mm-hmm. system. Yep. Another risk is that people will, create scams and, basically convince, newbies that don't kind of understand what's going on well to put a lot of money into the scams. Mm-hmm. A third risk might be that like something gets hacked and a lot of money gets stolen. A fourth risk might even be that like there isn't any kind of like theft or harm per se, but like someone's money gets lost, for example, because they just made a mistake. Mm-hmm. So I think depending on which of those risks you want to deal with, the mm-hmm. kinds of strategies that you might want to use in response are different, mm-hmm. right? So like, for example, I think if we talk specifically about the risk of a political capture, mm-hmm. like both Bitcoin and Ethereum have these pretty strong kind of detailed philosophies and often mm-hmm. Created through experience about how to deal with those kinds of situations, right? Mm-hmm. So like in the case of Bitcoin, for example, it's converged on this approach that says it should be very hard to change the protocol. Mm-hmm. And users and like people who run nodes by default should view the idea of installing an upgrade that changes mm-hmm. the rules with a lot of suspicion. Yep. And only really do it if there is a lot of like consensus among many different kinds of users that it's a good idea. Mm-hmm. In Ethereum, I think there is more of a balance between avoiding risk and innovation. And there are also some different ideas that are, I think, unique to Ethereum, right? So like, for example, the separation between implementation and specification mm-hmm. is one Ethereum idea, right? As like how if we have these many different clients and no single one of those client teams can single-handedly control the protocol. They have to accept changes, but then there also is this research team that's separate from them. Well, they're even a research community, not mm-hmm. just like a team within one organization that is actually developing these new proposals. So that is a different approach, right? It's like instead of kind of putting up walls and making things hard, it's, I guess, more of a pluralist strategy, mm-hmm. but it's also there, I think, to try to kind of create this stable political structure that ensures that the protocol develops well and governance doesn't get captured. Mm-hmm. If we're talking about risks of people getting hacked or people losing money, then a lot of the responses to that end up happening at the user interface level, mm-hmm. right? So like wallets, for example, they have teams that are doing a lot of work in trying to detect scams and hacks and different kinds of attacks and trying to protect their users from that, right? Like there's these wallets, like they even include their own blacklist of websites. Mm-hmm. So if you try to access a page where that page is already known to be a scam, then mm-hmm. the wallet doesn't take you to that page, and instead it shows you a warning. Mm-hmm. There is protection against accidentally sending many kinds of transactions. There's a lot of thinking going into the interface and how to make it harder for people to accidentally send certain kinds of things, or prevent maliciously created user interfaces from just immediately grabbing all of people's money. Mm-hmm. So I think depending on what kind of issue it is, you often see different parts of the ecosystem being the first kind of primary responder to it. And the response to different problems often looks very different.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So one specific question about one particular risk scenario, just to make things more tangible. What if the implementers, they, after discovering some research, decide to change the protocol to implement this shiny new research on a testnet or something, and then people collectively decide that it's a better idea, and then after years of testing, decided that it will reduce electricity use and therefore better for the planet, and then of course something unforeseen happens and that merge fails. So this kind of risk and scenario, and you've been planning around this with communities for many years now. So what kind of layers in the kind of multi-branch community structure that you just outlined is in charge, in addition to the cybersecurity and the auditing and the research, that guards against this kind of failure mode?
Sure. Yeah, I think there is definitely like many different layers of depth to the response, mm-hmm. right? So one of the layers of depth that you mentioned is just having a lot of like security testing and auditing. Mm-hmm. Another layer is the multi-client mechanism, right? Where if one implementation has a bug, then everyone running the other implementations like still functions well, hopefully, and so the network keeps functioning, and the people running the broken clients can hopefully just mm-hmm. quickly switch to the other ones. Mm-hmm. Other layers of defense are more at the social layer, right? So, like for example, there have been a lot of people who have been concerned that like miners would do something crazy near the end, because like ultimately, the merge is very much against miners' interests, because it takes away proof of work mm-hmm. and it takes away yep. the proof of work block reward. Mm-hmm. And like miners have been given plenty of warning about this, right? Like it's been known that Ethereum would eventually switch to proof of stake, like basically since the beginning. Mm-hmm. Have been this concern of like, would they try to like raise last minute objections, or would they try to even attack the network to try to prevent the merge from happening? Mm-hmm. And the response to that, I think one part of it is just having this very tough community norm that basically says, we agreed that the merge is happening, we're not going to we're going to put a very high bar mm-hmm. on attempts to stop it at this point. And if there is an attack during the merge, then there are even some backup options that have been written into the clients. So like users could just agree off chain on starting the chain from some particular block hash, for example, right? So like there's ways for people to coordinate off chain to recover if that's what we end up really having to do. There have also been like lots of discussions between the different groups to try to reduce tension, and like a lot of the miners, for example, like many of the ones that don't oppose the merge, like they don't oppose it because they're not just miners, right? Mm-hmm. Like they've known proof of stake is coming, mm-hmm. and they're not just miners; they're also going to, going to be stakers, mm-hmm. and like. Aligning people's incentives that way, so that like instead of defeating the enemy, you just don't have an enemy in the first place, and instead you have a friend. Mm-hmm. Like I think that's the best solution of all, if possible. Mm-hmm. So that's also something that like people in the community have done.
Mm-hmm. So it's like game warping, right? Taking negative sum or zero sum games and turning it positive sum.
The formulas, what were the formulas about? There were like formulas for the population of bunnies. There are formulas for like how fast bunnies can go over time and what their acceleration is, all of these different things. I think this was just the 7-year-old version of myself trying to create this kind of weird fantasy science fiction world that's just really cool. Definitely very impressed by many kinds of things and many communities in Taiwan. I've always appreciated in the local developer scene just people's ability to like people's excitements to learn and people's willingness to self-organize. Like there's just people who independently decides to go and form study clubs about various kinds of topics. Taiwan doesn't feel like it tries very hard to be impressive. It just kind of tries to be itself. And I think there's something very beautiful about that. I'm Vitalik. See you on Taiwan Plus.
I'm Audrey Tang. See you on Taiwan Plus.